It's stickier than usual bread dough, it's weaker, and it's fermenting at the speed of light. To make things worse, when I bake it into bread, it's likely to have a shorter shelf life too, with microbial spoilage happening at a quicker rate. And it's all because I took out one pretty powerful ingredient, salt. Hey, Seraphin here, and you might have already heard that excessive salt is bad for your health. The increased consumption of sodium or salt is considered to be the leading cause of cardiovascular disease and hypertension. Now, with more than 90 nations implementing salt reduction strategies, the pressure is on to find ways to reduce the amount of salt in foods while still making them palatable. Bread makers are not free of this pressure because bread is a leading source of salt in several countries, including the UK, the USA, New Zealand, and Australia. For context, the World Health Organization recommends an upper limit of 5 grams of salt per day, but global averages are around double that amount or more. According to the WHO, for every $1 invested in scaling up sodium reduction interventions, there will be a return of at least $12. With all that said, though, for obvious reasons, people tend to prefer foods with salt, including bread with salt. Although some traditional bread recipes call for no salt, like Tuscan bread, these recipes are often the exception to the rule rather than the majority. So in this video, we're going to go through some of the ways researchers have attempted to make bread with less salt more appealing to the general public. This includes adding salt in different layers of the bread dough, using MSG to compensate for flavor loss, and more. But before we talk about getting rid of it or lowering the amount of salt used, we do have to talk about what salt actually does. So that's why I've whipped up two doughs here, both of which are lean doughs made from the same recipe. It's just that one dough has salt and the other doesn't. And we're gonna see just how different they can be. Of course, my experience here is subjective, but the science behind it isn't. Now, the impact of salt on dough rheology is much more noticeable with slower mixing methods, especially when we mix by hand. Noticeably, the dough without salt is stickier than the one with salt. This is a well-known fact to many, and it's been shown that the impact of a 50% reduction of salt on stickiness is significant. The two doughs are also pretty different in terms of dough strength, and we can feel that when we pull on the dough. Let me just pick up one side. Here, actually, I think you can see it. Here, you can see the gluten network here. Well, this one is already starting to break apart. The science behind this phenomenon is that salt works to tighten the gluten, increasing its strength, and it does this by basically allowing the gluten to bond to itself instead of to the water inside the dough. This creates a stronger gluten network that can retain more gas. This is really important because it's part of what influences the bread volume and overall quality. But salt can affect bread volume in another way, which is through the yeast. You see, with yeast, the effect of salt is to slow down their growth. This is why the dough with salt rises at a slower rate. For the two doughs to rise to the same level, the amount of time required can vary greatly, and enough salt can cause the proofing time to basically double. So the dough with less salt will have more yeast to produce more carbon dioxide, but, and this is a big caveat, it doesn't matter if the yeast is producing a lot more gas if the gluten network is too weak to retain it. In the end, if the gas is not retained, the dough will end up with less gas, which means a denser dough and possibly denser bread. With that said, though, the science of salt's effects on bread-specific volume is somewhat conflicting. Various authors have reported that salt addition either increased, decreased, or had no effect on the bread-specific volume. This may have to do with differences in bread-making methods and wheat flours. One source explains that, in general, the overall effect of salt on dough development is small compared with the effect of mixing the dough mechanically. It's been shown that mixing time is correlated with increased volume, so perhaps a good takeaway from this is that if you're making bread dough with less salt or no salt at all, then you should definitely make sure that it gets enough gluten development by mixing it well. Salt has been shown to have an effect on the crumb structure. Bread without salt had larger air cells compared to bread with salt added. This is in agreement with the claim that salt is necessary for an even crumb structure. It's also shown that bread with even a relatively small amount of salt had a crumb structure that was significantly different from bread with no salt, which may indicate that there's a certain amount of salt needed to ensure an even crumb structure. The study also found that bread without salt was significantly harder compared to the bread with salt after 120 hours or 5 days, although there was no significant difference in hardness for 2 to 50 hours after baking. So if you're planning to eat the bread quickly, this won't be a problem at all. As for taste, bread without salt was described as having a high sour or acidic and sourdough or yeasty flavor. But to be fair, flavor is very subjective, and it also varies a lot based on fermentation time and the other ingredients. Now, this wasn't mentioned in the paper, but the increased sourdough flavor in the breads with no salt does remind me of another paper, and this is something that you might be more interested in if you like to bake with sourdough. With a sourdough starter, we have populations of both yeast and lactic acid bacteria, both of which contribute to the flavor of the bread and leaven it. The thing is that salt can have pretty different effects on the two kinds of microorganisms. In this paper, it was found that while a low level of salt, up to 0.7%, stimulated the growth of lactic acid bacteria, more salt decreased the bacteria's growth drastically and to a much greater degree than yeast growth. This is a pretty good reason for making sure to use a levain before making dough with a sourdough starter. Salt and sourdough both have one particularly useful benefit that they impart to bread, though, which is that they both extend the shelf life. In the case of sourdough, the acidity helps prevent microbial growth, and in the case of salt, it's due to something called the water activity. Water activity is essentially a measure of how much water is available or free inside of a food. Pure water has all of the water available and is given a value of 100% measured in equilibrium relative humidity, or ERH. If you manage to dry something completely, there's no water at all, so no water available, that would get a value of 0%. This water activity is important because bacteria and microbes in general need available water to grow, and these microorganisms are what cause the food to go bad. Bread typically has a pretty high ERH, 88% to 95%, which makes it pretty susceptible to microbial spoilage. Now, there are a couple of ways to increase microbial shelf life. Preservatives, for example, and traditional techniques like drying foods, and of course, adding salt. Salt is pretty effective in lowering the water activity because it basically reduces the amount of unbound water, the sodium and chloride ions associating with the water molecules, which is the principle behind salting meats to make them last longer. Additionally, compared to sugar in equal amounts, salt is 11 times more effective at lowering the ERH, or water activity of a food. So what exactly happens to the shelf life of bread without or with less salt? Well, one paper found that lowering the amount of salt from 1.2% to 0.6%, 0.3%, and 0% led to a significant reduction in shelf life of approximately 2 days, going from about 5 to 6 days to 3 to 4 days. Of course, though, these tests were done in relatively controlled conditions. In this study, the bread was exposed to a bakery environment for just 10 minutes before being sealed into bags, which means that the actual shelf life of these breads at home could be pretty different. This study does definitely show the power of salt in preventing microbial spoilage, though. Practically speaking, bread without salt is probably more prone to microbial spoilage, something we need to keep in mind when making bread with less salt. A good workaround for this is actually sourdough. The paper mentions that adding sourdough significantly prolonged shelf life, up to 12 to 14 days compared to the control. And with sourdough in the picture, the amount of salt added did not influence the determined shelf life significantly. To be fair, they were using a specific antifungal strain, so this may vary depending on the sourdough starter that you have, but in general, sourdough is well known for prolonging shelf life, so it's still worth adding if you want to make the bread last longer. All right, by this point, we've covered many of the main effects of salt on bread dough. So we can move on to talking about its reduction. And I will be mainly focusing on how researchers are influencing perception of breads with less salt. There's quite a bit of research on the use of additives and reduced sodium salts, but we won't be going too deep into that here. This is a pretty interesting area of research to talk about, and the methods applied range from rather obvious to incredibly interesting. As a flavor, we've gotten so used to saltiness that we just think of it as obvious. We might just equate the idea of adding more salt to making things saltier, but actually, flavor and how we taste things isn't such a simple picture. Some research is focused on compensating the lack of flavor in breads with less salt. And this is where we get to the idea of adding MSG to bread with less salt to make it more palatable. Yes, this is certainly a pretty controversial idea, but reasonably speaking, there isn't really any solid scientific evidence for MSG being bad for health, while there is a pretty sizable amount of evidence for the risks of consuming too much salt. Regardless of MSG's controversial reputation, though, it does seem to hold some promise in improving the flavor of salt-reduced bread. Some studies have demonstrated that the addition of MSG improved the taste profile of bread at reduced levels of salt. This was also found to work especially well when there were spices involved that further enhanced the flavor. But with that said, a study done in 2022 found that there was no significant difference in likability between reduced salt breads with or without MSG. To add more information, this study was actually partly funded by Ajinomoto, which is a multinational food corporation that sells MSG. In fact, it's said that they were the first ones to introduce MSG onto the market, so this is a pretty interesting study. Now, the differences in results between this study and the previous studies on MSG in bread may be due to differences in bread types and bread-making methods. As a home baker, I think that the idea of using MSG to compensate for less salt is pretty interesting, and it can be very convenient. But there are other ways to add more flavor to bread without MSG, notably inclusions like cheese or olives, which can boost flavor. You might also consider replacing salt with something more flavorful, like soy sauce. There is an intriguing paper on this, which actually examines not only how people first consider the taste of bread made with soy sauce, but also how their preference for it changes over time. So the paper examined consumer acceptance of two variants of bread. Variant A was a standard bread made with a regular amount of salt, and variant B was a salt-reduced soy sauce version with less sodium overall. For a period of 3 weeks, 56 consumers were given the regular bread, while another 59 consumers were given the soy sauce bread. The consumers were to exclusively consume the provided bread on weekdays. During the first 5 days, consumers preferred the regular bread, variant A, over the soy sauce bread, variant B. But that was only for the first 5 days. From day 6 onwards, there were no significant difference in average liking. I will note that the study also allowed for the consumers to eat the bread with fillings, so we're not exactly looking at what they thought of the bread alone. It is so interesting, though, that the liking rating for the variant A bread, or the regular bread, actually decreased by about 0.043 points per day, from day 1 to day 15. On the other hand, the rating for the variant B soy sauce bread increased slightly, but it didn't increase by enough to be significant. The authors ascribe this phenomenon to be perhaps because variant B, with its soy sauce content, was initially perceived as too complex or too novel, and therefore slightly less liked. With the longer exposure, consumers managed to overcome their initial uncertainty about it. A bit of a fun note is that the liking ratings for the variant B bread with soy sauce consumed with sweet fillings increased most overall among the variant B category, which I guess means that people eventually enjoyed the soy sauce bread with sweet fillings much more than when they started. I've never considered soy sauce and sweets before, but I suppose I'll have to try it. For some more context, this study was performed in the Netherlands, so the liking for soy sauce in bread could be higher or lower elsewhere, where soy sauce is more or less popular. As mentioned in the study's abstract, the results confirm that the first impressions of a new product may have little predictive value for its later success. Basically, don't judge a book by its cover, and don't judge a bread by its first bite. This leads me to the next method of salt reduction I want to talk about. Unlike the previous methods, this way is much simpler. You simply lower the amount of salt used in bread gradually. That is the idea behind this study, which found that a 1/4 reduction in the salt content of bread could be made without detection through accumulating 5% reductions in sodium over 6 weeks. There was also no differences in scores for flavor or liking in the study follow-up period. practically, this is actually useful for any home baker who wants to lower the salt in their bread. You might not have to sacrifice any liking of your salt-reduced bread if you do it gradually enough, which is kind of convenient because we can control how much salt we add to our breads. Another study with a total of 116 participants managed to gradually lower the salt in brown bread by 52% without leading to less consumption. This study setup was a buffet-style breakfast on weekdays for 4 weeks, and they found that reducing the salt in the bread didn't lead to any sodium intake compensation through sandwich fillings. So people weren't adding saltier fillings to compensate for the lack of salt in the bread. Among the fillings, they also found that pleasantness tended to be rated higher when the bread was tasted with ham. At a 67% reduction of salt in the bread, though, consumption did go down, so there is a limit to this. But when the bread was flavor compensated with potassium chloride and yeast extract, there was no decrease in consumption. Potassium chloride does have a salty taste, so that's likely part of why. And due to this, it's also sold as a salt substitute under different brand names. Like I said before, though, in this video, we're focusing on methods of reducing salt that don't require other additives or different salts. In line with that, this paper looks at the influence of bread texture on the perception of saltiness. The super short and simplified description of this paper is that bread that was proofed for longer had a significantly enhanced salty taste when compared to bread that was proofed for a shorter amount of time, or bread that wasn't proofed at all. As it turns out, the longer proofing times resulted in a bread with coarser and larger pores, which released sodium faster than bread with finer pores. And ultimately, a quicker release of sodium in our mouths means a saltier taste. According to the paper, a larger pore size leads to a softer crumb and fluffier bread with more volume. Now, you might recall that we've actually talked about the influence of salt on the breadcrumb. Salt gives the bread a more even crumb. Using less salt was shown to create a crumb with larger air cells. If we pair this study's results with some logical speculation, then reducing salt would likely make the crumb coarser and so increase the perceived saltiness. This is just speculation, of course, and we haven't factored in gas retention, but it's certainly quite intriguing. However, as the paper notes in its conclusion, there is a point where the bread pores would be too big and the crumb too soft. This would cause the bread crumb to turn into a lump during chewing and would result in a slower rate of sodium release, which means a less salty taste. We can take away a pretty simple idea from this paper: give our reduced salt bread dough enough proofing time to get nice and fluffy, as well as let it give us a saltier bread with larger pores. We aren't done with the methods that make bread taste saltier, though, because this paper has a very unexpected tactic. For most of us bakers, salt is something we just mix into the bread dough, but this study was done aiming for the opposite of that. The researchers distributed the salt throughout the bread dough inhomogeneously. They put different amounts of salt into different layers of the bread dough. So the way they did it was by making multiple doughs with different salt contents. Then these doughs were rolled out into sheets and layered on top of each other. Then the bread was baked into loaves. After testing it with a sensory panel, the researchers found that they were capable of 28% salt reduction in bread without loss of saltiness intensity using this method. Practically, this means that if the original bread's salt content was 1.8% of the flour's weight, then with this method, we could go down to below 1.3% of the flour weight without loss of saltiness intensity. The paper also states that the magnitude of the saltiness enhancement increases with increasing sensory contrast. So it's likely that the greater the contrast in salt levels between layers, the higher the saltiness enhancement. But this might not work for everyone. While the study showed a clear influence on saltiness perception in two consumer studies, this effect was less obvious on a trained panel in a quantitative descriptive analysis. To compound that, a more recent study done in 2019 found that this method of heterogeneous salt distribution was effective for 31% of consumers. So this method might not work for everyone. Well, at this point, we've gone through numerous methods to improve the palatability of bread with less salt. And as home bakers, a lot of them are pretty doable for us to do. And even if we're not looking to reduce the amount of salt in our bread, I think that the science behind it is still incredibly interesting and illuminating. So That's it for this video. Thanks for watching and bye!